The general practitioners are expected to play an increasing role in the management of thromboembolic disorders, including those occurring in the COVID-19 pandemic. GPs are expected to promptly suspect VTE manifestations, to treat home patients with superficial vein thrombosis and select patients with VTE, to assess the optimal duration of anticoagulation in patients with VTE, and to adopt proper preventive strategies such as in major orthopedic surgery, in oncologic surgery, and in medical patients. 20 years have passed since the publication of the Benelux study, a placebo-controlled randomized clinical trial, which showed for the first time that the administration of low molecular weight heparin in prophylactic doses, in this case, enoxaparin was used for a couple of weeks in high-risk patients admitted to medical wards, reduces by more than 50% the risk of VTE occurring during hospitalization. Two subsequent controlled clinical trials with a similar study design, the PREVENT and the ARTEMIS study, tested dalteparin and fondaparinux respectively and arrived at similar conclusions. It's interesting to note that in comparison to placebo, in each of the three studies, the rate of clinically relevant VTE, I mean symptomatic VTE or DVT involving the proximal vein system, was reduced by 50% as well. An important conclusion of the Mayo study is that doses of enoxaparin lower than 40,000 units once daily are virtually ineffective. This implies that the risk of VTE occurring during hospitalization in a variety of medical conditions is comparable to that expected in major surgery or trauma settings. Another important conclusion of this study is that an adequate thromboprophylaxis is likely to confer a long-standing protection against the risk of VTE complications arising beyond hospital discharge. In recent years, a number of models have been developed that have the potential to help stratify the risk of VTE in medical wards. One of the most widely adopted is the Padua Prediction Score. As you can see, 3 points each are given to active cancer, previous VTE, reduced mobility, and an already known thrombophilic condition. 2 points to a recent trauma or surgery, and 1 point each to elderly age, heart and/or respiratory failure, acute infection of rheumatologic disorder, acute myocardial infarction or ischemic stroke, obesity, and ongoing hormonal treatment. When the score is 4 or more, the risk of VTE is high enough to warrant thromboprophylaxis. As you can see in this slide, failure to administer proper prophylaxis in patients deemed at high risk based on the Padua Prediction Score leads to a dramatic risk of symptomatic VTE events both during hospitalization and beyond hospital discharge. Family physicians are expected to play an important role, are expected to implement prophylaxis in high-risk patients according to the Padua Prediction Score, in patients with acute medical diseases or exacerbation of chronic medical diseases whenever they decide to treat them at home. Several studies performed in the last 10 years have conclusively shown that virtually all acute infections, especially pneumonia, increase the risk of VTE complications. This risk is expected to increase in elderly people, in subjects with personal or familial history of VTE, obese people, people with thrombophilia, cancer, whenever prolonged immobilization is expected, in patients with renal failure, and in those receiving drugs such as estrogen, steroids, or antidepressant medication that are well-known drugs associated with increased risk of VTE complications. Let's now examine some aspects of the ongoing coronavirus pandemic. An impressive series of findings carried out in the past few weeks has led to the conclusive demonstration that in moderate to severe forms of the infection, there is a frequent activation of coagulation triggered by the release of cytokines, finalistically protective as it facilitates the entrapment of viruses. However, the response often leads to undesirable features such as microthrombosis with organ dysfunction, DIC with hemorrhagic risk, VTE, which often assumes the connotation of an isolated pulmonary embolism, arterial thromboembolism with features of myocardial infarction, stroke, and occlusion of peripheral arteries, and sometimes cardiovascular death. Here are a few examples of endoluminal filling defects so often recognizable in the CT angiography of these patients. And here an example of severe peripheral artery disease. In a retrospective investigation, this group of Chinese investigators assessed the incidence of either symptomatic or asymptomatic VTE complications in a series of 81 patients with severe disease who had not received thromboprophylaxis, which is a quite common conduct in Asiatic countries. As you can see in this slide, which summarizes the abstract of the paper, VTE complications were identified in 1 out of 4 patients, 25%. This is another important publication coming from the Chinese group. You can see from the algorithm indicated on the slide, about 450 patients were retrospectively investigated, of which 100 had received prophylaxis with enoxaparin at the usual doses. With the adoption of a score recommended by the International Society of Thrombosis and Hemostasis to quantify the risk of a coagulopathy occurring during sepsis, they collected baseline information on the dimer, the prothrombin time, the platelet count, the fibrinogen level, and the sepsis severity expressed by the SOFA score. As you can see in this slide, in patients scoring 4 or more, enoxaparin was found to reduce the risk of death from 64 to 40%. In patients who did not receive heparin, the red bars, the probability of death increased with the increase of the dimer, while during heparin prophylaxis, the blue bars, it remained stable, so that the difference between patients with and without prophylaxis increased according to the baseline value of the dimer. The results of this prospective cohort study conducted in approximately 200 consecutive patients in the Netherlands deserve attention. In spite of a proper prophylaxis with azoparin in low doses in the medical wards and in twice higher doses in intensive care units, symptomatic or asymptomatic VTE complications were detected in a remarkably high rate of patients. Subclinical or clinical coagulopathy had probably originated prior to hospitalization, thus limiting the efficacy of antithrombotic drugs. If this is true, the role of GPs is likely to be fundamental for the success against this disease and its complications. Now I take the liberty of expressing my thoughts in a very simple algorithm. While mild forms certainly do not require antithrombotic measures, and for the rapidly evolving forms hospitalization is necessary, in the moderate forms, which are by far the most frequent and in which the infection has the connotation of a flu syndrome, I strongly suggest, in the absence of contraindications, starting thromboprophylaxis at home in order to prevent the development of the thrombotic coagulopathy and of its complications. Among available strategies, the most widely used are the low molecular weight heparins in preventive doses, I mean enoxaparin 4,000 units once daily, to be decreased by 50% in patients with severe renal failure. How long? Until full recovery. In my opinion, it is desirable to continue for at least one more week beyond the apparent clinical recovery. I truly believe that GPs can play a key role in the battle against the COVID pandemic. Thank you for your attention.